Dear professors, dear holy priests, here today we will present the theological and dogmatic teaching of Gregory of Palamas on his writing the Ten Commandments according to Christ. Gregory Palamas was an important Greek prominent theologian priest who was born in 1296 in Constantinople. His family was noble and belonged to the court of Emperor Andronicus II. At the age of 7, he became orphan because he lost his father. Despite his terrible loss, he managed to be educated with imperial scholarship. He studied the works of the church fathers of the previous centuries and the logic of Aristotle, but he didn't manage to deepen his knowledge with a serious study to Plato. In 1326, he had his ordination to be priesthood. During this period that Palamas lived as a monk, he underlined the inaccuracies of Lyokpe. Also, he supported that the light that monks sing during the Hesychast prayer is uncreated as the light of the Transfiguration on Mount Tabor, and explained the distinction between God's essence and attributes. In 1347, he became archbishop in Thessaloniki of only Greek Macedonia in the Byzantine Empire. As archbishop, he continued to defend the Hesychast tradition with passion. He died in 14th November 1359. For Palamas, Hesychast can participate in theophany and theopty of God, if they put into practice the presupposition to be united with the Holy Spirit. The unity with the third person of the Triune God enables man in his charismatic theosis. Gregory wrote his works about Moses, the Decalogue, in order to share his sense of the immediate experience of God, given to man by God by virtue of the Incarnation. Generally, Gregory Palamas analyzes the Ten Commandments in order to show that the strict monotheism of Moses, the Decalogue, reveals the Triune God attribute. Finally, in Palamas' interpretation of the Decalogue, we find the teaching of Isidore of Pelusium. We should not try to search how God is, but to know that God, that He exists. By this way, Gregory explains that the mystical motivation of Decalogue is the love among the three persons of God, among people and God, and between each man with the other. The dogmatic teaching of Gregory of Palamas on his writing, the Ten Commandments according to Christ. Gregory Palamas analyzes the first commandment, the Lord our God is the Lord is one. As the basis of his theological teaching, he underlines that God is one and at the same time has three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The once and at the same time Triune God is said not once but two times is the analysis of this commandment. But by this way, the Greek Macedonian bishop shows how important it is for him and for all Christians to realize that this alone is God, and alone is true God, and the one Lord in a trinity of hypostasis. Generally, he summarizes the dogmatic teaching of Christianity from the previous centuries above the common and the hypostatic attributes of the divine persons, the unbegotten Father in the Son, who is begotten eternally, tunelessly, and impassibly as the Logos, and who through himself anointed that which he assumed from us, and so is called Christ, and the Holy Spirit also comes forth from the Father, not begotten but proceeding. Gregory clarifies that the Son of God incarnated in order to unite God with people. So by this way, the latter will have earned the ability of the objective salvation. Additionally, he rejects Filioque, because he underlines that the Holy Spirit comes from the Father, ek tou patros. From his proceedings, perhaps Gregory teachings about the hypostatic attribute of the persons of God, because he wants to speak about the rejection of filioque with indirect way. The heretical teaching about filioque was a great problem after schism among Roman Catholics and Orthodox Christians. And Gregory continues his analysis to the first commandment and adds the order of God from the book of Deuteronomy. And him alone shall you love, and him alone shall you worship with all your mind and with all your heart and with all your strength. And his words and his commandments shall be in your heart and with all your strength. And his words and his commandments shall be in your heart, so that you carry them out and meditate on them and speak of them both, sitting and walking, lying down and standing up. The views of Shema by Gregory underline the connection of this Jewish prayer of the Old Testament with the New Testament and with Christian theology within a clearly visible pedagogical and theological frame. In this frame, God reveals himself as the one who creates the world and reveals his three persons in a different stages of the redemption of the world. Gregory underlines that we should remember the Lord our God always. Why does he say something like that about in his analysis? Perhaps the verb mnemonevis, remember, becomes similar to the verb prosevis, because you remember God when you pray to him. We can assume that Gregory indirectly refers to the intense hisiaspration, a prayer from which an intellectual fire is ignited. This fire purified the one who prays with passion to God. Then the result is the boundless love of God inspires the soul, and the physical heart manifests this interior communion in grace by spiritual palpitations. During intense prayer, the mind becomes inflamed with intellectual fire, and then the body too experiences lightness and warmth. In continuum of his teaching of the first commandment, Gregory explains that God is the creator of every creature, visible and invisible. The only thing that God asks from any man is to love him, to put into practice his orders and fear him. This fear cannot possibly be expressing something that appalls and intimidates the believer. The latter belongs in Christ's church, the body of Christ. He and the rest members of the church love and simultaneously fear Jesus Christ and bring you God as Savior and head of the church. This is the holy fear of the church, which is born out of the bounteous love towards the one who incarnated in order to save man from the death and from the trap of Satan. This fear is expressed and displayed as an extreme reverence towards him, as a reverence towards his commandment, as an extreme obedience towards him, and as a willingness to please him. This love of the believer towards God is expressed as a fear that he may fall short in something and forfeit his love by having proven himself unworthy of it. Some of the characteristics of God, which exist in Psalm 102, 8 line, are underlined by Gregory of Palamas. So he characterizes God as compassionate, merciful, long-suffering, full of mercy, and internally bountiful. All these attributes of God spring from his love to people. They are the reward to people who believe in him and follow his commandments and his teaching. As just he is, he is going to punish evil people with the eternal hell. Who live away from him or reject their creator in their actions, words and thoughts to the east kind of rejection, Palamas implies all the heretics of his era who didn't accept the uncreated energies of God and had adopted the heretic teaching about Philopemen. In the interpretation of the second commandment, Gregory argues about the creature of universe generally, which was created by God in the Holy Spirit through his Son and Logos. By this way, Gregory summarizes the patristic thought of the previous centuries. God is the creator of everything, so must not worship anything for God. Saint Gregory speaks about the incarnation of Christ using words from the creed of the first and the second ecumenical councils. So in few words, the Holy Father teaches about the incarnation of internal word into a virgin womb. He associated with men and who, for the salvation of men, suffered, died, and arose again. Gregory underlines that Christ was risen as total man and total God. Christ's body was glorified at the moment of this resurrection, as proved by the new and supernatural properties in subsequently and permanently enjoys. Then Christ returned to his Father, because he is the only one who came from the Father, and he can return to the Father. Christians can worship and venerate only him as God. Saints are not God. With this clarification, Gregory expresses the most important teachings about icons and the relics of saints in a short and clear form. He says that icons of Christ and saints should not be divided, but through them we should venerate him, ineffable compassion to assume the human image and to circumscribe by it. Gregory clarifies the Christian teaching of worship icons, relics of saint, and the Holy Cross, because in his age there was the heresy of Bogomils. The latter denounced the icons and the cross as idols and the worship of saints and relics as idolatry. It is underlined that the cross became the symbol of Christ's victory against Satan and his angels. Also, the reverence and veneration shown to icons, however, is not directed to mere paint, wood, or stones, but towards the saint depicted. Additionally, the holiness of the saints in their soul and in their body derives from their jealous grace and virtue. Bestowing lives in the body of the Church of Christ, of Theanthropos, by this way they have been friends of God. Here it is important to be analyzed that Gregory teaches that the cross was permanently presented and saved the human race from destruction and annihilation, and it was prefigured throughout the New Old Testament. The sign of cross in Jewish history can be found in many parts of the Old Testament, especially in Exodus 17, chapter 1, line 16, in Numbers 21st chapter 4 to 9 lines, in Daniel 3rd chapter 23 line, and 6th chapter 23 line, and etc. Generally, the icons and the symbol of cross bring the heart of Christians into a pure relationship of love. To sum up, Gregory Palamas, in the analysis of this of the first two commandments of dialogue, presents with a synoptic way the Christian triadology. One God and at the same time Trinity, he speaks about the common and hypostatic energies of the three hypostases of God. And he underlines that the Father is the source of the other two persons because the Father gives birth to his Son in eternity, equal to himself, and he is the only who proceeds the Holy Spirit in eternity. Then Gregory speaks about the incarnation of Logos, who became total man and remained total God. And finally, Gregory refers to the dogmatic teaching for the veneration of icons, the cross, and the relics of the saints. Now we go on with the second part of our project, the theological teaching of Gregory Palamas on his writing The Ten Commandments According to Christ. Gregory Palamas accepts that the Ten Commandments are the clear and compelling statement of God's will. He tries and manages to make reformation of the Decalogue through the evangelist and patristic tradition. By this way, he succeeds to lead any Christian from the law of Moses in the Old Testament to the law of Christ in the New Testament. So he underlines the difference from the letter of law to the spirit of Christ's law. Moses' law could save people from death, but Christ's law opens the gate of the objective salvation people and then leads them in the eternal life and deification. Gregory's theological teaching starts in the third commandment. Do not take the Lord's name in vain. This order has to do with the perjury rather than blasphemy. The Holy Father includes in the third commandment, the ninth, against false witness. He advises that the Christian should avoid taking a false oath because this is a rejection of God. It is better for any Christian not to take any oath, but instead of this, the believer must make a rule never again to take an oath and with tears to ask more immediately, intensively for God's forgiveness using the different remedies. In the fourth commandment, Gregory underlines one more time the difference between Old and the New Testament. Here the difference has to do with the day which is dedicated worship of God. This day was Saturday, which defines the final day of the creation of the universe. Gregory speaks about Sunday as holy day instead of Saturday. He explains why Sunday is an important day, why for Christians, and shows the etymological connection between Kyriaki Sunday and Lord Kyrios. This day, a believer could examine himself to see whether he would do that or not. He has transgressed or overlooked any of the commandments, and he should correct himself in all ways. It is obvious that Gregory has combined in his mind the Old and the New Testament. His advice reminds us the passage from Lamentations. Let us test and examine our ways and return to God. And from the second epistle to Corinthians, examine yourselves to see whether you are in fight. Test yourselves or do not realize that this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fall to meet the test. This purpose of the introspection should be related with the coming of the temple of God and attendance the services held there and with sincere faith and a clean conscience, Christian should take part in the Holy Eucharist and receive the Holy Body and Blood of Christ. By this way, he should make a beginning of a more perfect life and renew and prepare himself for the reception of the eternal blessings to come. As it is profane, Gregory agrees with the teaching of other church fathers, as John Chrysostom, who accepts the attendance of the Holy Divine Liturgy united with the mystery of Holy Eucharist, so according to their theological teaching, the concrete and fundamental cause of the sacred, transcendent and tremendous character of a liturgy is not an elevated idea or religious feeling, but the gift of the love of God, which is history, laid down on the altar of this sacrifice. In the fifth commandment, honor your father and your mother. Gregory put some presuppositions about their religions with their parents. If they believe in Christ and live a life according to his teaching, then they should be loved and honored by everyone, by their children. Sorry. On the opposite side, if the parents and heretic Gregory advises their children to cut off any bond with them, in this case, people are excused to hate their parents, their spouses, their children, because they are barriers to their salvation. Gregory expanded the meaning of the word parent, and he concludes not only the natural fathers and mothers, but also the spiritual fathers and mothers. The spiritual parents have struggled against heretics with their dogmatic and theological teaching. But Gregory doesn't mean only patristic father. He refers to priests who are spiritual leaders of faith. They have brought up the believers from a state or mere existence to a state of virtue and spiritual health. They have transmitted to the faithful the illumination of knowledge we have taught them when the revelation of the truth have been given a rebirth through the water of regeneration that have installed in them the hope of resurrection and immediately of the eternal God and inheritance. Now, the Gregory refers to the mystery of the confession between with the help of a priest, we can heal the wounds of our soul. Only the priest, the spiritual father of the presence of priest, only through priest, the believer can heal his soul from any sin and can be forgiven. The presence of a priest is obligatory in the mystery of the confession because the priest, as the successor of the apostles, has the responsibility to guard the faith, to preserve the integrity and to of the church and the souls of Christians, as Jesus Christ said to the apostles. Whoever sins yet remit by they are remitted, and whatsoever sins for retain, they are retained in sins they submit and they are remitted, Jesus Christ said to the apostle, whoever sins here remit, they are remitted, and whosoever sins to retain, they are retained. Whatever sins you remit, they are remitted in heaven. For all these reasons, Gregory connects this commandment more with the spiritual father and the internal father. Whatever sins yet remit, they are remitted in heaven. For all these reasons, Gregory connects this commandment more with the spiritual father and obey them till the end, so that you may save your lost soul and inheritance all from her father. And we have all of your father in the here Gregory's found out the chance to speak about the birth of Christ from the Holy Virgin Mother in order to underline the significance of virginity in a Christian life, and additionally he refers to the role of the Holy Spirit of the historical birth of Christ besides the teaching of word incarnation. Gregory says with emphasis that the Holy Spirit impenetrably proceeds from the Father alone, not by way of the generation, but by procession. By this way, he rejects the inaccuracy of the heretic teaching of Filioque. Gregory speaks about the 10th commandment, you shall not kill, and analysis is not a simple moral order, but he tries to find the real cause of murder, which is the rage and the anger. For this reason, Gregory advises that passions as anger, rage, revenge cause a disease of the soul which can lead a man into a number. If we respond to someone who reveals us with forgiveness, he will be forgiven by God himself. Gregory underlines that it is difficult for some believers to show forgiveness when they are faced with evil way. For this reason, the Bishop of Thessaloniki underlines. But if you are unable to bridle your temper, can censure yourself whenever you lose it, and repent before God and before anyone to whom you have spoken and have acted evilly. If you repent and the ascension of sin, you will not commit the sin yourself. But if you feel no pang in committing mirror offenses, you will through them fall into major transgression. In the 8th commandment, you shall not steal, Gregory doesn't remain only to the evil of the theft, but he goes one step further, and he refers to the charity, the philanthropy that a Christian should show to other people by giving some of these goods in a secret way. His reward will be major in the eternal life. On this comment, for God's order, it is obvious that Gregory has in his mind the words of Christ. Therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogue and in the street, that they may have glory from men. Assuredly, I say to you that they have their reward. But when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly. Concerning the 9th commandment, you shall not accuse anyone. Fortunately, Gregory relates the one who accuses unjustly his neighbor as the one who put the blame on Eve in God's question. Additionally, the Church Father underlines that not only someone shouldn't accuse anyone falsely, but also he should keep in secret the evil action which his neighbor will do in order to protect him. Finally, in the last commandment, Gregory advises that the Christian should refrain from converting that belongs to the others, and so far as he can, avoid fleeting things out of greediness. Also here he speaks about the philanthropy and the mercy that the believer of Christ should show to people who need money or some goods. In this commandment, we can see the summary, mainly of Cappadocian fathers, and not only of them, teaching about the philanthropy and charity in Christianity. As a conclusion to this work, Gregory says that if we put into practice these orders of God, following the correct dogmatic teaching of the Church and the dialogical moral teaching of the New Testament and Church Fathers, we will be saved only by the grace of God, who is worshipped and venerated with his Father and the Holy Spirit. Gregory starts and finishes this typological work with the reference to the Triune God, who is the creator of everything and is beyond place and time. Conclusions. Gregory Palamas teaches the 10 commandments were declared in the Old Testament, and all of them were reiterated in the New Testament because collectively they continue the law of God. He examines the Ten Commandments in light of the New Testament. He connects the correct dogmatic teaching of the church with the moral life of Christians, which has a center Christ. Of course, Gregory doesn't speak about the simple humanism, which has man in the center, but he teaches a man's moral life that springs from the union with God. A Christian who has a moral life, in fact, he strives to unite himself with God in church through the Holy Sacrament. In this work, Gregory follows the teaching of other church fathers, support that the man's issues are not moral in nature, obeying and doing things because they are right, moral, but ontological in nature. The 10th commandment in the light of the New Testament teaching show that human salvation is not a juridical matter, it is utterly ontological. If we manage to be united with Christ, we will succeed the deification. In this attempt, the commandments are the light which shows us the correct road in order to earn the mercy and the grace of Christ, to be united with him for the eternity. And now I would like to thank you all for your attention. Thank you so much.